Well, we need more people in the great middle.
One.
All right.
Two. One.
We all set, Patty?
One.
Oh, good. Just checking.
One. Two.
We are almost all set. Yeah, your apologies accepted. And you're ready. Father, we have come to exalt you. You are worthy of all praise and glory. Your mercy is everlasting, new every morning. Father, we thank you that we can assemble together with the saints, that we can lift up your name with one mind, one heart, one voice. Be exalted in our midst, Lord. Speak to us today. Pour out your grace, we ask. We're looking forward to all that you have for us. And in Jesus' name, they all said,
amen.
Amen. The blood of Jesus is incredible stuff. It cleanses us from all unrighteousness. It is the atoning work on the cross that stops the wrath of God upon us. Boy, you can't. There's nothing else that'll work, but that will. And we're thankful that we, as believers, will not have the wrath of God abiding upon us. What a thing of mercy that is. Hallelujah. So let's sing about it.
Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you washed in the blood, in the soul-cleansing blood of the Lamb? Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you walking daily by the Savior's side? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you received each moment in the crucified? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Sing it! Lay aside the garments that are stained with sin and be washed in the blood of the Lamb. There's a mountain flowing for the soul unclean. Oh, be washed in the blood of the Lamb. Sing it! Are your garments spotless? Are they white as snow? Are they washed in the blood of the Lamb?
Amen. Hallelujah. Something to shout about, amen? So we'll just do that. Let us shout to the Lord, shall we? Hallelujah.
My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my day, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, power and refuge and strength. Let every breath, all that I have, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing her joy at the work of your hand. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, helplessness, beauty, and strength. Let every death, all that I am, never cease to worship you. Shout to the Lord, all the earth, let us sing. Power and majesty, praise to the King. Mountains bow down and the seas will roar at the sound of your name. I sing for joy at the work of your hand. Forever I'll love you, forever I'll stand. Nothing compares to the promise I have in you. My Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you.
There is none like him. Jesus said that unlike the kings of the earth, he was talking to his disciples, who were, as usual, having a fit about which one of them was better than the rest. And he said, the Son of Man came to serve, not to be served, and to give his life a ransom for many. Of course, that was his first coming. Now, his second coming, he's not coming to serve, unless you consider serving up your enemies on a platter, but he's coming to judge at that time. But he's telling his disciples, those who will remain until his return, that includes us, that we are also to serve and not to seek to be served. It's that humility of Christ, of all individuals in the universe, who didn't need to humble themselves. He did. He humbled himself by letting go of deity. Well, he didn't let it go, but if you will, changing clothes as a metaphor and taking on the flesh of mankind, that's pretty humbling for the God of the universe. For a people that don't deserve it, that's pretty humbling stuff. But then Paul doesn't stop there in Philippians 2. He goes on and it says, but he humbled himself to the point of the cross. Now dwell on that for a while, and you'll recognize how great is his grace, how wonderful his mercy. That if he was a servant, we're to be one also, amen? Be a servant. Humble and meek, Lord, let me lift up those who are weak, and may the prayer of my heart always be, make me a servant, humble and meek. Lord, let me lift up those who are weak, and may the prayer of my heart always be, make me a servant, make me a servant. Of all comfort, God of all grace, we have come to seek you. Come to seek your face. Because you have called us, oh, we're gathered in this place. Oh, we have come to seek you. We have come to seek about all he's done in your life, how he saved you from the wrath of God to come. Because you've called us,
because you have called us, we're gathered in this place. We have come
why we're here. We've come to seek his face. Hallelujah. We come to seek him. He's always there, amen. Lord thy God, in the midst of thee, he is mighty, so mighty. A little faster. The Lord thy God, in the midst of thee, oh, he's mighty, oh, so mighty. And I saw him high and lifted up with power and grace and authority. And he shall reign in the midst of thee forever and ever. Amen. The Lord thy God, in the midst of thee, oh, he's mighty, so mighty. Lord thy God, in the midst of thee, oh, is mighty, so mighty. And I saw him high and lifted up with power and grace and authority. He shall reign in the midst of thee forever and ever. Holy Father, I come boldly to your throne, thirsting, longing for your presence alone. Hear me, O God. Hear me, O God. Holy Jesus, forever the same, mold me in your likeness, hide me in your name. Hear me, hear me, O God. Hear me, hear me, O God. Holy Spirit, lead me in your way. Spotless, blameless, made ready for that day. Hear me, hear me, O God. Let's sing, hear us. Hear us, hear us, O God. Hear us. Hear us, O God. Holy Father, I come boldly to your throne, thirsting, longing for your presence. Now, Father, we do come seeking your face, seeking your presence alone. Nothing else compares. We hunger for you. And Lord, even while we're saying to ourselves, even now, but I'm not really hungering at the moment, we cry out, Father, and say, help us to hunger for you. We need your help. We need your help. We want to be servants like the Lord Jesus Christ. Make us servants, O God. Mold us in your likeness. Make us ready for that day. Oh, Father, we're weak. And we understand that we're full of compromises. We're not proud of it. We just recognize it's true. And we need your help. Because we want to stay focused on you. We want our mind renewed. We want it transformed. Our whole bodies, our whole spiritual walk, transformed by the renewing of our mind, the mind of Christ that you've given us. We seek your face today, Lord. We lift up Dale. Our brother has just been fighting it and fighting it and fighting it. And he's just one thing after the other. Lord, we ask, Father, that you would pour out your mercy upon him right now. Where in his room, Father, that your grace and your mercy and your healing touch would just flow, just like flowing from the mountaintops, that your balm of Gilead would saturate him, and that he would recognize that you're doing something wonderful and powerful in his body even right now. And that he would say, man, I got to get up. I got to start doing some stuff. I got to get healed. I got to get ready. I've got to get back to the body of Christ. Because there's a servant, Father, Dale Bender. So, Lord, we cry out for our brother, knowing that you hear our prayers and that you respond, that you move. Father, we thank you. We thank you also for healing others who are not here today that may be feeling a little low. Just bless them, strengthen them. And we thank you, Father, for all the different ministries that occur here through this body here that most people don't even know about. Lift them up, Father. Encourage them. Show them your face. Encourage your people, Lord. We have come to seek you. Reveal yourself to us, O Lord. And they all said, amen. Let's take time to fellowship for a while. And we got some neat stuff to show you. Speaking of ministry going on, Walk for Life and all those kind of things.
Good snacks, huh? Praise the Lord. All right, we've got Heather here today as the representative for the is it still CareNet? CareNet. I can't remember their names anymore. Our liaison to the CareNet ministry, which you all contribute to through the church. So that's one of the ministries that we support with your tithes and offerings. And she's got a presentation, I guess the video's first, and then she's going to talk to you a little bit.
You walk for them.
They helped me when I found out I was pregnant. I was so afraid and had no place to turn. Because of them, I have my baby. When you walk for us.
I was so scared to be a dad. I thought abortion was our only option. I'm so thankful they were here for me, for us.
I thought choices I made in my past were unforgivable. They pointed me towards hope and healing.
You helped my mom choose life for me. When you walk for me.
Every dollar you raise makes a difference. Will you please join us?
Hear me?
Yep.
So a couple months ago, Dale was looking for volunteers, and so I decided probably a good thing, right? It's a good cause. So I didn't have a chance to go through meeting with the CareNet staff. Dale was wanting to transition and have me like tour and stuff, but obviously he's been not
laid
doing
up.
Well. So I reached out to the staff member there this week, and I apologize for, you know, this information being last minute, but this CareNet walk is May 20th. It's one of the big fundraisers that they have throughout the year that helps keep their doors open, basically. It's like a third of their budget. So you can either, if you're interested in signing up to walk, it's on May 20th. Josh and I are going to be walking, so you can either, we'll take your money, or you can join us, either way. come see me, though, even, you know, either way, if you're interested. We've got till that day of. And the information, if you're interested, I'll give you all the details on it, but I think it's going through on the slide. So, either way. That's basically it, as of right now. And then, you know, as the year goes by, I'll have other information to put out, but come see me if you're interested about the Walk for Life. It's May 19th. No. May 20th, sorry. That's my anniversary. May 19th. That's on my mind.
Okay, if you have any questions about the Walk for Life, see Heather, and she will help you out. Oh. Let you ingest that for a second. Can't see it? My report today is on King David. You know where King David wrote his Psalms? Under a psalm tree. That's a dad joke. I'll bet David would have thought it was funny. Well, in his lighter moments, I'm sure he would have. And we've seen, we're in 2 Samuel chapter 5. I'm only going to do verses 11 through 16. today I'm going to have mercy on your souls and your backsides. We see that David has now cleared all the hurdles of Saul's house, of his kingdom. It's over. God took care of it, etc. He's now king of a united Israel, which was the big, you know, hope as they wanted to end that civil war between the house of Saul and David as king of Judah at that time. Now, David knows that God has protected and promoted him for just one purpose: to be a blessing to God's people and the forerunner of the messianic son of David, which is Christ himself. We're going to see in these couple verses the kindness of Hiram, who is king of Tyre. That's God's proof, because he's a Gentile, he's a pagan, whatever. It's God's proof that he's exalting David's kingdom for the sake of his people Israel. He's causing these foreigners, these pagans, to come alongside Israel and help them out. That's when you know that's God, when that starts happening in that part of the world, right? And of course, this blessing, this exalting of David's kingdom for the sake of the people, that's a foreshadowing of Christ's kingdom. And we know that God took on flesh and paid the price of sin so that his people, his called out ones, if you will, would dwell with him in the eternal kingdom. These facts alone make us feel wunderbar, or wonderful. Thought I'd translate that for you. However, our feeling warm and fuzzy is not the whole counsel of God. There's more to this than just us feeling good, which I think is extremely important. A lot of preacher teachers just concentrate on making you feel good because you give more money that way and don't give you the whole counsel of God. But God wants us to understand the whole counsel of what he says because it all makes sense. Immediately in our passage here, we're going to go from David's faithful behavior, which we'll see, and all of a sudden, unfaithful behavior. It happened so quick, we feel like we've experienced spiritual whiplash. One moment, David is God's faithful king, and the next, he transgresses God's word for what? For his own fleshly pleasure. The multiplying of wives is a direct disobedience to God's word, and David knows it. He didn't do this by accident. He knew. He did it anyways. Now, this disobedience about multiplying wives, that's going to dog David's heels throughout his life, and it's going to result in his son, Solomon, compounding this sin. What did he have, 300 wives and concubines? Or something? It's just insane stuff. And the backlash flowing from David's sinful compromise will infest Israel with idolatry, which is why God told them not to do it. It will divide the country, the nation, and eventually it's going to result in deportation to foreign lands. Sin has consequences. Sometimes we just say, oh, you know, it's not that bad. God will wink at this. It's not as bad as so-and-so is doing. That has nothing to do with anything. It's what does God say, and what are we doing about it? You see, sin, as we see in the Scriptures, it's compared to the different things. It's compared to the kingdom. Leaven is compared to the kingdom of God. You know, it grows slowly, but then all of a sudden it takes over. But it's also used to speak about sin. You've heard the phrase, a little leaven leavens the whole lump. So a little bit of sin will eventually leaven the whole lump. And that's why the contrast is shown so starkly and so quickly in this passage. You're getting ready to get up and cheer for David. He's finally on track. He's finally done. Oh, garbage. There he goes again, acting like a human being. I hate it when he acts human. First point, David's kingdom was established for God's people. We need to look at that. Let's look at our text today, beginning with verse 11. 2 Samuel chapter 5, verse 11. And Hiram, king of Tyre, sent messengers to David and cedar trees, which means logs, building materials, Also carpenters and masons who built David a house. The better translation, of course, is a palace. And David knew that the Lord had established him king over Israel and that he had exalted his kingdom for the sake of his people Israel. It wasn't for David's sake. It wasn't for publicity's sake. It was for the sake of his people. God's concerned about his people. He's concerned about you. Are you one of the called out ones? Of course you are. That's why you're here today. Otherwise, you'd be playing golf or going fishing. Okay? You're one of the called out ones. The ecclesia, those that are called out. The people of God, those that he has chosen before the foundation of the world and has brought to pass your existence that you might be his child. You've been given the right and the authority to become the children of God. This is God's plan. And this is why, and David understood this part, that God did all this, put him finally, his promise came true, put him in the throne, gave him the crown. For David's sake? No. For the sake of his people Israel. This is important. Proverbs 16:7 says, when a man's ways please the Lord, he makes even his enemies to be at peace with him. And that's what we see happening here. Hiram noticed what's going on. I mean, they had their reporters, they had their intelligence thing, and they saw what was going on in Israel, and they watched and bided their time. They're on the coast, Tyre and Sidon, up north, okay, Gentile territories, and they're watching to see how this thing all comes about. And sure enough, David rises to the top just as, you know, the reports were that God was going to make it happen. And Hiram saw this, and he said, I need to make friends with this guy. This is quite unusual how all this came about. I think that would be a good ally. So on a strategic level, why did Hiram cozy up to David? Well, he sees David is gaining strength. His kingdom is gaining strength, growing, and Hiram wants to be an ally. He didn't want to be an enemy of somebody right on his border, gaining strength. That's dangerous. Just ask Taiwan. Also, economically, there's always money involved somewhere, isn't there? And economically, Hiram needs access to the inland trade routes, because they went right through Israel's territory, as well as the agricultural produce of central Palestine. So for everybody involved, it's a win-win. Hiram wins, he gets what he wants. David wins, he doesn't have an enemy on his doorstep, and he's actually got a friend who's sending masons and carpenters and in truckloads, well, they use trucks, but, you know, cargo loads of cedar logs from up north. Remember the cedars of Lebanon and all that kind of stuff. And he's volunteering to build David a palace. Wow, friends like that, who needs more friends? I don't know. Now, let's look at where Tyre is. There it is, Tyre and Sidon, just about 25 miles apart, I think. Yeah. The Phoenicians, that's what they're called, and they were a seafaring people. The Phoenicians of Tyre were not a nation divinely destined for conquest by Israel. God wasn't going to deal with them in that way. So consequently, David could accept Hiram's favors without dishonoring God, and that's a good thing. David formed an alliance with Hiram, knowing that it was God's blessing for Jerusalem's prosperity. How blessed would the United States be with this kind of spiritual insight inhabiting the Oval Office? Things would be different. Spiritual insight, you can't buy it. You can't trade for it. It comes from knowing God and hearing him, which is why we sang some of the songs we sang today. It's all for the sake of God's people. David understood that his kingdom was entirely dependent upon God and that God himself had made him king over all Israel. We've been through that, we've tracked it, we've seen it. This is probably the most important point of the whole passage, that God put him there for the sake of God's people. As God's promise, which we've talked about endlessly,
comes to fruition, David revealed himself to be a ruler after God's own heart. David understood that the kingdom was not provided him for his own glory. Isn't that refreshing? But for the sake of God's people, Israel. God did not provide the kingdom so David could reap the benefits of being king, but so that he might operate as a servant towards God's people. Make me a servant, humble. See, yeah. But who's the ultimate servant? It's Jesus Christ, our Lord. How blessed would our nation be if politicians serve the people instead of their own egos and wallets? We wouldn't even know how to deal with that, would we? That'd be a time change, a shift in alternate universe. But what we see here is the kingship of Israel was a means to an end. It wasn't the end. God has more in store. God provided the Davidic kingdom for the benefit of God's people at the time, but ultimately, and this is what we need to see, to bless believers through the Son of David, the Lord Jesus Christ. David's kingdom is a type and shadow of the kingdom of Christ. And under the reign of Christ, we see that leaders are called to be the servants of God's people. David understood this. The church needs to understand this. Make me a servant. Wow. In Mark 10, verses 42 through 45, speaking of servants, we've referenced this verse several times this morning. You remember the thing with James and John and their mommy? Would you please place my sons on either side when you come into your kingdom? Typical Jewish mom. And Jesus looks at her. Says, you don't even know what you're asking. You think you can drink the cup that I'm going to drink? Oh, yeah, we can swill her down. We don't even need a straw. What pride, what arrogance. They had no concept. And I think Jesus was thinking, because he's, of course, is God in the flesh. She's thinking, one on either side of your eternal throne. He's thinking, how would you like a place on a cross on either side of me? Can you drink my cup? You think you can? And then he goes into some teaching. Because those two, as arrogant as they were, Sons of Thunder was their nickname. And of course, they got their mama running point for them. The rest of the guys were just as bad. They were human beings. Ego. Centric, wanting a better place, a higher place in the coming kingdom. And Jesus says, he called them to him and he said to them, you know that those who are considered rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones exercise authority over them. But it shall not be so among you. Shall not be so among you. Wait a minute, there's a loophole here, right? Nope. This isn't how it works, folks. But whoever would be great among you must be your servant. And whoever would be first among you must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. Well, I guess that's good enough for me. I hope it is for you. Man. That's right down to point blank range. There's a book written, I can't remember who the author was, it was when I was in college, which of course was so far back that, there's no written materials about anything then. But it was called The Upside Down Kingdom. And it was about the kingdom of God, of course, on earth and, of course, eternal. The Upside Down Kingdom, why did he call it that? It's because what we consider normal, what we consider right side up here in this world is absolutely incorrect and 180 degrees out. We see the kingdom of God as something that's upside down. No, it's right. It's correct.
what you see around you in this world, that's all upside down. That's insane. And that's what Jesus is getting to. You've heard it said. You know, the Gentiles, the high ones, they lorded over, you know, their subjects and this, that, and the other. That's how that works. Everybody understood what he was talking about. That's how stuff works. Sure, but that's not how it's going to be with you. You're going to serve one another. Whoa. And if that didn't hit home, he said, that's why I'm here. Of course, they didn't catch the gravity of that at the moment, but they would. And of course, 12 of them would turn the world upside down very shortly because they grasped it. God's requirement for service is not restricted to King David, of course. Christ insists that all his disciples hold to this vision of service. It is especially required of those placed in church leadership. The egos of James, John, and their mothers, as we were talking about Matthew 20, that sparked Jesus to call his call to serve God's sheep rather than lording it over them. This is an all too familiar scenario in the church. Pastors and other leadership personnel often allow their inflated egos, or the desire to seek recognition, to have unchecked power, and even adulation. They want all that at the expense of the sheep. It happens in many places. You've seen it. You may have been part of churches where you saw this. You experienced these kind of things. But you can see it's all around. It's all around. You know why? Because sinners are all around. They're people. What do people do? Peoply things, yeah. But it's pure evil. Ooh. Short to the point. God speaks often in his word about the judgment he will shower upon unfaithful shepherds who abuse his little ones. You remember that phrase? What do you immediately think of? Oh, he's talking about kids. No, he's not. I'm not talking about children, unless you realize you're a child. See, God's judgment will fall upon anyone who causes his little ones to stumble. Little ones means the powerless ones who have no recourse but to cry out to God for justice against the powerful, the little ones. It was rampant then. It's rampant now. Come, Lord Jesus. Amen. Jesus came the first time not to be served, but to serve and give his life as a ransom for many. And we're not greater than our master, are we? No, we know the scripture. In fact, common sense would tell you that. See, we are also called to serve, to lay down our lives for one another, to build up the church, to spread the gospel of the kingdom and bring glory to God. There is no place in God's church for peacock strutting leaders building up their own kingdoms on the backs of God's sheep. Amen. Oh. This is the kind of stuff that when you see it, you just black out and just get angry seeing what's going on. Happens all the time. Anyways, David is on the right course here. He recognizes God's made him king for the sake of his people, Israel. Bully for David. He's got it. He understands. He's going to be a good king that way. And then, well, as I said in this point, I called it concubine cultural compromise. Say, what in the heck? Well, hold on. Verse 13. Right away. And David took more concubines and wives from Jerusalem after he came from Hebron. And more sons and daughters were born to David. And these are the names of those who were born to him in Jerusalem: Shammua, Shobath, Nathan, Solomon, Ebhar, Elishua, Nepheg, Japhia, Elishama, Eliada, and Eliphelet. Say that three times fast. Now, why is that here? Why did the inspired writer of Scripture put that right here? He wants you to see a contrast. He wants you to recognize something. Now, we've just considered the power and glory of David's rise to the throne. And we know that David is a king after God's own heart, for he knows that he did not receive the kingdom for his own glory. He received it for the sake of God's people. And from this spiritual and moral high point, the writer immediately confronts us with David's fleshly folly, his cultural compromise of multiplying wives and concubines. This is a direct violation of God's word for a covenant king. Deuteronomy 17, 17. David knew this verse. This is not foreign stuff to him. Deuteronomy 17, 17. And he, meaning the king, shall not acquire many wives for himself, lest his heart turn away, nor shall he acquire for himself excessive gold and silver. Obviously, anything that's going to distract him from serving God and therefore serving God's people. You can't have all these distractions. And the main thing with adding wives was always idolatry. Always, always, always. He said, no, don't do that. Don't marry foreign wives either, which Solomon obviously did not listen to. Because why? They bring their gods in. And then the guy finally, you know, acquiesces. He gets tired of getting nagged, whatever. Who knows? And the next thing you know, you got idolatry in the camp. And the next thing you know, God is sending prophets and saying, better knock it off. Better knock it off. I love you. I'll take care of you. But I'm telling you, stop this stuff. Or I will send in people you don't even know who are going to take you and do things to you you don't want to even hear about. Sure enough, it happened. Did it happen right away? No, God warned over hundreds of years and warned and warned and warned. See, the curses of the original covenant with Moses said, if you start doing stuff like this, these are the curses that will come upon you. And God is just saying, I told you once. It's not a secret. You know this is the truth. And sure enough, boom. That's why covenant kings were not to multiply wives, because it would destroy the kingdom, which goes right back to Genesis. And a man shall leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife. Not wives, his wife. That's the way it was from the beginning. That's how God intended it. But we see David right away sinning. In 2 Samuel 3, Scripture, you know, we go back just a chapter and a half or whatever. Scripture says six sons were born to David at Hebron. By the way, as I looked this up and started researching, it's six different wives. He was a busy guy throughout the week. I guess he needed a day off. I don't know what's going on here, but in Jerusalem, now we find out, 11 sons were born to David. That's not counting all the daughters. They don't list all that. 11 sons were born to David. The mother of four of the Jerusalem-born sons was Bathsheba. Little foreshadowing. The mothers of the remaining seven sons are not recorded. Might lead you to think maybe concubines. Who knows? Now, why did kings do this? Now, we know why all the other kings did it, but why in the world would God's covenant kings do this? Well, because they wanted to be like everybody else. They thought, they believed that the more sons they had, that would be an indication of royal strength, not to mention having a baseball team. Therefore, this quiver full of sons should be a blessing to David according to human reasoning. If you think about that way, the way everybody else was thinking, oh yeah, you got all these sons. It shows the strength of your kingdom and this and that. And you'll have them all around protecting, and you can put them to work, and your kingdom will just continue to grow, and then you'll have grandchildren. It never works that way. Because you got royal power at stake, and then you've got people who are doing people-y things. David's sons are not protectors of their father's rule, but they're a constant source of intrigue, rebellion, heartbreak, murder, and sorrow. Why? Why is this so? The answer is simple, because the multiplying of wives is rebellion against God's command for a covenant king. When you transgress God's commands, there's judgment. There's response. When you're a covenant king doing it, to whom much is given, much is expected. The punishment goes up just a bit. When we purposely rebel against the word of God, God in perfect justice will dispense judgment, and there's no exceptions. And in this short passage, the writer would have us contemplate David's strength and his stupidity. Boom. Both of them, side by side. David's a picture of us in our process of sanctification, which, if you've been in a theology class or whatever, you've seen me draw this on the board 100 times. Sanctification is the time period in this life where you as a Christian, from the point of salvation, the point of redemption in your life, when Jesus Christ came in and regenerated you and you said yes to the Lord Jesus, salvation. From that point until you go home, which we call glorification, when it all is accomplished at once, our life is like this graph. Now, it should be the upward call of the prize of Christ, right? It should be that upward call. So we see our graph is continually moving upwards. That's a good thing. But notice what's going on in the middle. Peaks and valleys, ups and downs. As a Christian, has it all been a real smooth ride all the way up? Have you had some peaks? Have you had some valleys? Yeah, that's how that works. That's why it's called the process of sanctification. Sanctification, the root word, is holy. We are being made holy. The way the scripture says it is that God is going to conform us to the image of his Son. That's what's happening there. The process is tough. We don't cooperate all that often. Sometimes we have to take a valley just to get our head straight. And then God's right there in mercy. But that's how it looks. That's what David's up to. You know, in one moment, he's on a peak. Right away, the author shows us the next moment he's in a valley. Again, David is every man. We see ourselves in him. And so we should learn. We should learn from his story. That's why it's here. So what are the takeaways from this passage? First of all, David was an admirable leader, wasn't he? We consider him a hero of faith. He was a good leader. Did he have mistakes? Did he do some stupid stuff? Yeah, but he was somebody we look to as admirable. We think that's pretty good. He understood that he had the kingdom for the sake of God's people. God said, therefore, he's a man after my own heart. I'm going to bless him. He's got Hiram, king of Tyre, sending him all sorts of building materials and laborers, and everything seems to be going well, and then little valley. Disobedience, but we'll see him come back up again. We know that David sought to be faithful to Yahweh. That was in his heart. He wanted to be faithful. Do you want to be faithful to God? Y'all say yes, every head's okay. Are you always faithful to God? This is the movement right here. No. Does that grieve you? Everybody's neck loose up now? Okay. Yeah, you understand what's going on here. We all understand what's happening here. David's every man or woman. Don't want to offend anyone. David sought to be faithful. But David compromised obedience when it came to multiplying wives. Darn, David. Why do you do stuff like that? It makes us all look bad. You see, David's high point is followed by his cultural compromise of multiplying wives. I thought, one small step for man, one giant leap for disobedience. Sorry, Neil Armstrong. Just because, and this is the thing, it was a cultural thing by this time. It's against the Word of God, but by this time, the Word of God had been watered down enough that it just became the way the culture is. Can't you just go with what's going on? Why do you always have to fight against, you know, these mental ill perverts that are dressing up and like girls and whatever? You get the drift. It's here. There's nothing we can do, but let's just compromise. Let's just let it go. I'm so tired of fighting. It's called compromise. It's not healthy. It's not healthy for sinners because nobody's holding them accountable. It's not healthy for us because we're transgressing God's word. And plus, we're chickens. It's not healthy. And yet, because it's now the culture, we've just acquiesced to it. And that's what David did with multiplying wives. Everybody was doing it. Everybody was doing it. All my friends are doing it. Why are you so mean? Why won't you let me go do that? Because it's not right. Oh, you're always, you just think you're so pure and holy. So you got to take the slings and arrows when you want to stand up for righteousness. Amen? Yeah. Because the culture approves of something does not make it right. I bring to you abortion. Our culture thinks pretty much 50% think it's okay. Actually, even more when you're talking about politics. What are we doing now? We're debating on 15 weeks. You know, let's get a compromise. So what you're telling me is murder is okay for 15 weeks. Well, I'm not saying that. Yes, you are. That's exactly what you're saying. Compromise. The culture's moved us in this direction. How about defunding police? Wow. That was a cultural phenomenon, wasn't it? And everybody started doing it. They wanted to keep up with Minnesota and Minneapolis there. And of course, San Francisco and LA are just real hot spots for fun and games. Watch your step. What about sexual deviancy? Well, we just have to accept this kind of stuff because that's the way it is. We really shouldn't judge people. Wow. Compromise. How about prioritizing criminals over their victims? That is the opposite of justice, which is therefore the opposite of what God thinks. And yet, you see DAs throughout the country going this route, and what do you see in their cities? Chaos. Chaos. You couldn't pay me enough to ride the subway. Unless I had a submachine gun. That'd be kind of fun. Gonna push me, are you? No. See, the art of compromise may be a virtue in politics, but it invites disaster and divine discipline in the kingdom realm. And that's what we need to be aware of as believers. Old Warren Buffett said it takes 20 years to build a reputation and 5 minutes to ruin it. If you think about that, you'll do things differently. Well, I'd hope that would be true, but I'm not sure. Ernest Brahma said this, he's a writer. A reputation for 1,000 years may depend upon the conduct of a single moment. Man. And then, of course, that great evangelist in the 1800s there, Dwight Moody. If I take care of my character, my reputation will take care of me. We just really need to focus on Christ, right? And things will be taken care of. So what's another takeaway? Well, our observation of David's behavior should cure us of Christian hero worship. Well, you see that so often. I remember when I was in Bible school in Phoenix, Grand Canyon, now university. You may have heard about this. This is way back. We're talking late 70s. Little Richard supposedly got saved. I don't know if he did or not. I'm not the judge on that. But what I did experience was that someone, maybe the guy that led him to Christ, I don't know, but somebody got a hold of him and the Southern Baptist Convention, and they made him a star immediately. They put him on stage. We went down to North Phoenix Baptist Church, the biggest church in town at that time. And there's little Richard giving his testimony, playing his stuff, tutti frutti, woohoo, you know, and all that kind of stuff. And I'm watching this, and I'm a dumb kid. I'm an idiot. I don't know one end from the other at this point. I'm watching that and going, this isn't going to turn out well. And it did not. We have a tendency to want to get somebody to put them up front just to show the rest of the world, see, we're not so bad. We're not so bad. So-and-so is speaking for us. Be careful. You'll ruin people doing that. We've got to watch that Christian hero worship stuff. You could admire, I admire Billy Graham, but I don't worship him. He's not my hero. But I think he's worth listening to and following some of his stuff. He was smart. Ultimately, the kingdom of God is safe only in the hands of David's descendant, who always does what pleases the Father. Who would that be? Of course it is. John 8:29. He said, "He who sent me is with me. He has not left me alone, because I always do what pleases him." Wow. Praise the Lord that Jesus, through the Holy Spirit, dwells within us. He's here, within us. His Spirit is dwelling within us, and we cannot help but bear spiritual fruit that lasts. That pleases the Father. If you're a believer, you're going to bear fruit that lasts. That's part of the deal of John 15. That pleases the Father. So let's wrap it up. David realizes that God has made him king for the sake of God's people. The throne's not about him. It's about serving Israel. He is laying down his life for God's people. This is a foreshadowing of the coming Son of David, who, though the King of all creation, will lay down his life for his people. As children of the King of Kings, we are to sacrificially serve the body of Christ for God's glory. That's every single person in the room. No exceptions. We also need to understand that compromising God's word for the sake of our flesh will result in stunted spiritual growth. Compromising God's word results in a compromised character. A compromised character wounds our witness. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word. This little passage, Lord, it shocked me to the core to see the contrast so startling after you revealed it. But before that, it was just reading on through. But Lord, you're showing us something here. It's very powerful. And Lord, we want to be servants. Obviously, your servant, but servants of one another so that you would be glorified through our witness. Help us, Father. We see it all with our intellect and say, well, that's good. That's what I want to do. But we find ourselves compromising daily. We ask that your Holy Spirit would speak loud to our hearts that we might hear and that we might follow you. In Jesus' name, they said, amen. You're dismissed.